Good morning. Thank you for the encouragement. I'm still nervous. For those of you who are wondering, when they say 70 years old, it does not mean the composite total of age of the people in the car. Okay, it's referring to the driver, huh? Only driver, okay? So those of you who are able drivers, not 70 years old, please drop off the 70-year-old at the ground level, assisted to the service, and you park at the multi-story car park, okay? We had discussions like this in my car many times. Just want to share with you all today a lot of scripture verses, as you can see. I want to thank Anna for typing all these out. This is to make it easier for some of you who don't have to keep on turning to the Bible or flicking here and there, not sure where you are. But I will have to speed read it a little bit because we won't be able to finish it in an hour. The topic for today is, how do you love? How, as in what method? How do you love? How do you show love to one another? We know in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4, the first part it says, love is patient. Have you all seen this plaque many times around? Love is patient, love is kind, and then it goes a lot, correct? Okay, so the first part says, love is patient. Now, when we do a Bible study, it's like, you want to understand, what is patient? I don't want to give you a Webster dictionary definition, because it may not be what the Bible is implying, or may not be the full picture of what the Bible is showing. So what we do is that we look for verses using a concordance, using the same word patience, and this helps give us an idea. What does the Bible mean when it says in this particular verse, love is patient? What does patient mean? Is it the same patience as what you are thinking in your mind? Or does the Bible have a different aspect of patience that we are unaware of? When you say someone is patient, what do you imagine? You imagine someone who's cool, calm, doesn't get flustered, never raise their voice, always say monotone, doesn't go faster and talk faster and go higher and screech higher. You know, that one is a very impatient person because it's going to work out. No, but a patient is calm and cool, you know, like these ladies here. You know, when you say patience, who do you think of? What is the idea you have in your head? So in Matthew chapter 18, our first verse for today, this is the story of the unforgiving servant. When Jesus was asked by Peter, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times, Jesus said to Peter, I do not say to you seven times, but up to 77 times. And goes on to say that the parable was that a king wanted to settle accounts with his servants. One servant owed him a lot of money, and the servant came before him and said, have patience with me, I will pay you all. And later on, this servant went out to find another servant who owed him just one coin of money, 100 denarii, and that servant said to him, have patience with me, I will pay you all. So what is the idea of patience in this passage? It's like you've got to wait for someone to clear a debt with you. Have you had people owing you money? Have you had people owing you something? So you have to be patient while waiting to collect that debt. What kind of patience is that? That is the idea when you say love is patient. If you are not patient waiting to collect the debt, you could have just strangled the fella there and then, or sent the fella to jail, right? But being patient here means you are waiting for the debt to be repaid. Next verse, 1 Thessalonians 5:14. You can go back and read the rest, take your time. In 5 verse 14, it says, we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. So what does the word of God say? Be patient with everyone. We cannot pick and choose who you want to be patient with. You cannot pick and choose who deserves your patience and who doesn't deserve your patience. Because the word of God says, everyone, all. So if someone runs through your mind and God is telling you, and you say, huh, that one I know lah. Well, I'm telling you, God says everyone, including that person, yes. James 5, 7 to 10. This is talking about being patient while waiting for the second coming of the Lord. And also in verse 10, it says, my brethren, take the... You see, I'm reading from my New King James Version, and this is NIV. Brothers and sisters, an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. So one is being patient, waiting for the second coming of Jesus. Do you all know Jesus is coming again? Because if Jesus doesn't come again, we are very sad people. It's like, I'll be asking you, what are you coming here for? What are you here for? If Jesus is not coming again, we are very sad. We are disillusioned. We are pathetic people. But we are not. Jesus is coming back, okay? So we are all being patient, waiting for the coming of Jesus again. Now, when we wait for the second coming of Jesus, how do you feel? Do you feel impatient while waiting for Christ to come again? Do you complain to God every day as you read the papers and about the things that are happening? Jesus, you don't know how rotten these people are, you know. You read about senseless killings and you tell God, God, you know how violent people have become? You see about road rage and things like, it's like, God, people are going crazy. They're losing self-control. It's like, it's dangerous to even sit in a coffee shop and eat. I better face the entrance all the time. I don't know who's coming in and what they're going to do next. We can become paranoid. We can become fearful. Is that how we are when we are waiting for the second coming of Christ? Or sometimes we carry on with our daily routine that we forget that Jesus is coming. Until we come to church, and then we are reminded that Jesus is coming again. How are we waiting patiently for the second coming of Christ? And verse 10 says, take the prophets as an example. What kind of prophets is the Bible talking about? You have prophets who prophesied that the Jews were going to be taken up from the promised land and were going to be brought into captivity because they were disobedient to the ways of God. You also have prophets who prophesied the return of these Jews back to the promised land and telling them that God is faithful, God will still love them, God will let them suffer for a while and then bring them back to the promised land. You also have prophets who prophesied of the birth, life, and the reign of Christ. Like we're going to have Christmas. There are many prophets who never knew who Jesus was, who never could have imagined who Jesus was, but they prophesied because as the Holy Spirit told them, this is what is going to happen. And the Word of God says, take these prophets as an example of patience. Something that you know God has put in your heart, but you haven't seen it yet. And you don't know when it's going to happen. That is an example of patience. In Hebrews chapter 6, verses 12 to 15, we do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. This is talking about God making a promise to Abraham. Now, when God first made the promise to Abraham, his name was just Abram, and he was 75 years old. And God told him, leave your kampung. Leave where you were born and raised in. Go to this place which I will show you. No ways, no Google Maps, no road signs. But God just says, where I will show you. And he obeyed the Lord and he went out. And the time that God met him again, when he was 90 years old, when God told him, now I will change your name from Abram to Abraham. From 75 to 90, how many years is that? 15 years. How long have you waited for anything in your life? What's the longest? 15 years is a very long time. For some people, they haven't even lived 15 years of their life. You know, but it's 15 years. When my going-to-be husband told me that he would marry me after he graduated, that was 6 years. You didn't study 9 years. 6 years. Okay, it was a promise to wait for 6 years. You know, but you see what happens. But this promise is not so bad. I mean, like God's promise is like akan datang next change kind of thing. You don't know what's going to happen. At least this one, you know, you can see something, and you know, as dates go by, it is something that you carry on. It's not as difficult as Abraham's patience. But what do you do while waiting for the fulfillment of that promise? What do you do with that patience? How do you wait? That is that patience. Patience is the quality that does not surrender to circumstances or succumb under trial. What does succumb mean? Succumb means to fail to resist pressure. Like within the 6 years, if somebody else comes along and say, I can give you a better life, forget about him, like he's so far away, you know, that kind of thing. And if someone chases after you and say, okay, do not succumb under trial means I do not give in to that pressure or to that temptation or to some negative force or to give in or to surrender. So that's what patience means. You do not give in. You do not throw in the towel. You do not give up. It is also associated, it is opposite of despondency, opposite of despair. And it's associated with hope. Now, these verses were not used referring to God. These verses were used referring to us, humans. So from these verses, what is the idea of patience that is building up in your mind? Is it the same as what you imagine patience to be? Patience waiting for a debt to be collected. Patience waiting for Christ to fulfill his promise. Patience knowing that what God says will happen. Or hoping what God says will happen. Another word that is used to mean the same thing is long-suffering. You have Exodus 34, verse 6, and Galatians 5:22-23, this is referring to the Lord. God is long-suffering. The fruit of the Spirit is long-suffering. This NIV version gives you as forbearance. Another version says it as patience. How many Holy Spirit do you have? How many Holy Spirit do you have? This is not a trick question, okay? How many Holy Spirit do you have? One, okay? Now, what we read in Galatians 5 is 9 aspects of the fruit of the Spirit. Sometimes we think that, I have a lot of love. I've got a lot of joy. Only patience, I don't have enough. So I pray to the Lord and ask God to work patience into my life. But you see, these are all aspects of one Holy Spirit. We don't have 9 Holy Spirit. You cannot say, I want to add this, I want to minus that, so that it will all be balanced. It doesn't work that way. How it works is that as we fellowship with the Holy Spirit, as the Holy Spirit influences our life, all these different 9 aspects will grow and cultivate in our lives. So you cannot say, I only want to be patient, I don't want to be gentle. Or I want to be gentle, I don't want to be patient because I'm thinking of someone I cannot be patient with. It just doesn't work that way. The Word of God is such that we cannot cut it up into compartments or in portions that some portions you like, some portions you don't like. So the ones you don't like, you don't follow, you just ignore it and put it in the drawer. It doesn't work. Because one day God will knock on your heart and remind you of the portions that you just skip. Because God works in totality in our lives, in every aspect, the parts that you like and the parts that you also don't like. For example, just like giving. When people come up here and ask for you to give towards mission or for something, And you'll be thinking, you have no idea the troubles I have. I barely make it every month, and you're asking me to give. Some of us think like that. And it's so easy for so-and-so to always encourage us to give. Many of us do not know, do not realize that most probably the person up here who is encouraging you to give had to go through experiences with God himself that he learned to give. And because of that, he's able to stand in front of all of you and encourage you to give. Because he is able to testify with his life that, yes, I have gone through it, I have tested the Lord, I have seen God faithful to his word, faithful to his promises. Therefore, I am here encouraging you to give. Why? Because God needs your money? No. But because in giving of yourself and of your money to the Lord, you will experience God in such a way that you have never experienced before. And that is only the experience that you can have with God. And it is a precious thing that unless you learn to give, you will never know. So the next time you see someone standing here and asking you to give, don't react and think, you know, I've got it bad. What to give? Because when you come before the Lord and say, God, I only have so little, what can I give? If you set your heart such that I want to give, what can I give, Lord? God will show you. It may not be in dollars and cents. It may be your time. It may be your effort. It may be you doing something, but it is the start of your experiencing giving with God. And so with this patience, what is patience? Do you say patience only belongs to church leaders and full-time workers and parents and teachers? We all normal people can be slightly less patient. Does it work that way? No. Because it's for you, for me, for everyone. Romans 2 and Romans 9. It's saying about God's goodness towards us. When it says God is patient towards us, it is God showing his goodness towards us. And what for? Why is God good to us? Why is God patient with us? Romans 2:4 says, it is for us to lead us to repentance. Does God happy? Is God happy if any of you die in your sin? No. Because Christ came to save you. He cannot be against himself, right? Why would he give his son for you that he loves and then after that he decides to zap you and punish you because of your sin and kill you? No, it doesn't make sense. God is patient with us so that we will come to repentance. And it is God's goodness. Sometimes as parents, you know, we try to withhold privileges, we try to corner our children in a way, actually, to put it bluntly, we try to bully our children to behave the way we want them to behave, to make decisions we want them to make, or to say things we want them to say. I'm being frank. You know, sometimes as parents, because we are so exasperated, we don't know what to do with them, we try to corner them in such a way that they have no choice but to agree with what we want. Is that called goodness? It's not. We can make them do the things we want, but we have not changed their heart. We have not changed their spirit. But God is patient towards us. God is good towards us. Why? He wants our heart. He wants our heart to respond to him. He wants repentance that comes from the heart, not just lip service saying, sorry, God. Why is God being patient with all of us? Why when you look at another person in church or you look at your parents or you look at your children or you look at your colleagues and wonder why God hasn't changed them yet? Because God is being patient that he will lead them to repentance. 1 Peter 3 and 2 Peter 9. Let's reach 2 Peter 3 verse 9. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone come to repentance. That's the basic thing. So when you look at someone and you think, you still haven't changed, same last year, this year, still the same. Say sorry how many times, still the same. Don't know when it'll ever change. think of how God looks at us. What is God saying to you? Is God saying, hi, last year the same, this year also the same, going to be Christmas, still haven't changed? Is God going to say that to you? If you were God and you looked at yourself, would you say that to yourself? Many times we would. But God doesn't say that. Because God's goodness, He's being patient with us, that we will change. Amen? So one way, if you want to grow in patience, is if God was in your shoes, what would God say? When you are thinking of being impatient with someone, think of it. If it was the other way around, what would God say to you? All these scriptures were referring to the Lord. And it says, long-suffering is a quality of self-restraint in the face of provocation which does not hastily retaliate or promptly punish. We do many things to make God angry because we break His commandments. And looking at it, God has every right to be angry because He is God. But yet God withholds His anger and is long-suffering and is merciful towards us. And what is mercy? Mercy is not giving us what we deserve. What do we deserve? We deserve death. We deserve punishment. Sometimes we make it sound not so bad, you know, because we don't call it sin. Sin sounds serious. Weakness sounds not so bad. Bad habit sounds not so bad. Human mistakes sounds not so bad. When you say sin, it sounds terrible, right? But actually, we have all sinned. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. And what is the punishment for sin? It is death. But why are we all still living and still carry on life as if nothing happened? Why? Because of the goodness of God, because of the long suffering of God, because of the patience of God. So how do you love? Do you love like the Lord or do you love like another human being? In Ephesians 4, why are we patient with one another? Verse 3 says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Why are we patient with one another? Why should we be patient with one another? For unity. Colossians, live a life worthy of the Lord. As a new believer, as a new creation in Christ, have patience. Have long-suffering. Please go home and read the verses yourself. 2 Timothy 4 verse 2, it says, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. What struck me as I read this is that we say how difficult it is to preach the gospel. Because we get rejected, because people don't accept what we want to say. So what does the Word of God say? Be patient. What does being patient mean? Continue. Continue. Don't give up. Don't give in. Don't surrender to all the pressure. Continue. Continue preaching the Word. This is what I thought about when I was going through these verses. It's like a triangle, a love triangle between God, me, and you. Or between God, you, and somebody else. It's like a love triangle. Why? Because what's the first verse? First and greatest commandment in the law. I'm sure some of you know this by heart. Love the Lord with all your heart and with all your soul. And with all your mind, and with all your strength. Okay, that's the first and greatest commandment. And the second one is, love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, those of us who have been in church long enough, we know this by heart, right? Love the Lord with all your heart, and love your neighbor as yourself, right? We all know that. Okay, so that's one side of the triangle, loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's the second part of the triangle, love your neighbor as yourself. What is the third part of the triangle, third side of the triangle? Jesus says, a new command I give you. Who was he speaking to? He was speaking to his disciples. He's speaking to people like us who come to church, who say that we are followers of Jesus. He's speaking to us. Not those who come to church only twice a year, you know, Christmas and Easter kind of thing. But you who come to church every week, who are involved in church, who come to cell group, Jesus is telling you this. A new command I give you. What is it? Love one another. And then you think, eh, didn't he tell us to love each other the other time already? Why does he call it a new command? As I have loved you, you must also love one another. So what's the difference between this third side and the second side? Second side was just love your neighbor as yourself. But now Jesus is asking you some more. Love one another as I have loved you. Not so easy, yeah? By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. So you cannot say that I want to love God because it's the easiest thing. You love God, no problem. It is people that give you problem. God never gives us problem, right? And then everything compared to God. God is always right. We are always wrong. What's the problem? Just say sorry, God, and get right. But it is loving one another that is difficult. Loving your neighbor as yourself. Okay lah, since I love God and God is good, I can learn to be like God and be good as well. But the third part, loving one another as I have loved you. It's very challenging. Because when we come to love, it's patience. Man, I have to love you as how God loves you. You know, it is not just a chapter in the Bible explaining to me the aspects of how God loves me, what it means when God loves me, what is this agape God kind of love. It is saying like, as God has loved me in this manner, so I must also love you. As patient as God is with me, I must be patient with you. As good as God is to me, I must be good to you. Let's read 1 Corinthians 13. Let's talk about love. Love is patient. Love is kind. Okay, let's not put love, because love is third party. Let's put it as I. Okay? Because we are supposed to love as God loves. Alright? So let's put it as I. Right? I am patient. I am kind. I do not envy. I do not boast. I am not proud. I do not dishonor others. I am not self-seeking. I am not easily angered. I keep no record of wrongs. I do not delight in evil, but rejoice with the truth. I always protect. I always trust. I always hope. I always persevere. Go home and think about it. When it says, I am not easily angered, I read this book before that says about seven deadly sins, and the first aspect was anger. And this author was saying that the reason we get angry is because it affects our pride. Parents get angry with children. Why? Because we feel at the back of our minds is that our children should know how to behave. Our children should know what to say and what not to say. Our children should know of our expectations of them and they should meet those expectations. Our children should know their responsibilities and carry their responsibilities. So when they do not fulfill that, we get upset with them. We get angry with them. Because we feel that whenever they fail to meet that expectation, it reflects poorly on us as a parent. That we have not taught them properly, we have not trained them properly, or something like that. Is that true? Not many of us can say that we have righteous anger like Jesus. Okay? If you think about the many times you have been angry, how many times do you qualify of as having righteous anger like Jesus? And there was only once in the Bible when it said about Jesus throwing out the money changers and the thieves in the temple. But do we ever hear elsewhere that Jesus was angry? When we deal with one another, you know, sometimes, like my mother was telling me, before she came to church and before she served in church, life was happy as a Christian. The longer she serves in church, the less happy she became. It's the same for many of us. Why? Because when you're in church, you expect everybody to be perfect because we all love Jesus. When you come to church and serve with one another, when you attend cell group, not so perfect. Just the same as people outside, like non-Christian also. And then we get upset with one another. This is when I want to remind you that we are all work in progress. We are all being patient with one another because God is patient with us. We are far from perfect. There are many areas in our lives that needs to still change. But God is patient with us. When we look to one another, when we deal with one another, this is what we have to remember. That as much as God is patient with us, as much as God is long-suffering towards us, we in turn, I am patient. I am kind. Why? Because we want to show love to one another, that the goodness of God can be shown through us, that our fellow brothers and sisters and friends will respond to the goodness of God and come to repentance and change their ways. Yesterday, I was asking the congregation, if your child or your niece or nephew or your neighbor at 14 years old comes and tells you, I've met the love of my life. I'm going to marry this boy the moment we finish studying. What would you as a parent react? How would you react? Good riddance, no need to look after you anymore, is it? Would you say that as a parent? Or as a concerned aunt and uncle, if this 14-year-old tells you, wow, I really love this boy, what would you say? What would you say? I don't ask trick questions, just tell me, what's the response in your head? What would you say? Puppy love. You don't know. It's just puppy love. It's just for a while. It will pass. It will not last. But I'm the 14-year-old, and it's like, this boy is very nice to me, very kind to me, buy me presents, wait for me, help me do my homework, teach me what I don't know. You know, doing all the things for me that my parents don't do. You know? How do you say it's puppy love? Because the more you tell me it's wrong, how can I say that these feelings I have is wrong? I feel it. Why do we call it puppy love? Because we, the older people, have made our mistakes in the past. We have learned through the sadness of our life that this is called puppy love, it won't last, you know. Now everything is fine, there's no pressure in life, you know. When you have to face the real world and you have to earn money and you have to support one another, this one won't last, lah. You know, the statistics show you in the world that marriages fail, money is number one problem, all that kind of thing. You tell 14-year-old how to understand. But it says here in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11, okay, it's not in the verses. I'll read to you. It says, when I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. So when you say it is childish love, what do you imagine? No problems. Childish love is now. I want it now. Childish love, very easy to satisfy. Buy you ice cream, you love me. Give you lollipop because my parents don't let me eat lollipop. I love you, auntie. I'm going to Universal Studios. I bring you along. Oh, thank you. Love can be bought. Love can be bribed. Childish love. Childish love is also overly sensitive. Have you seen kids playing? One moment they're the best of friends, you know, sleep together, eat together, shower together, everywhere also to go together. Why must you go to toilet together? Also go together, you know, small kids kind of thing. But sometimes the smallest thing happens and the next moment, I don't want to talk to her. I don't like her. I want to take everything she gave me before and give it back to her. You know, it can change within the hour. That's childish love. Same thing with one another. How do we love one another? Is it with childish love or is it with matured love? Is it with human kind of love or is it with God kind of love? Let's do a self-check. Think of somebody who is challenging. It's easy to love people who don't give you problems, right? No effort made. Think of someone who's challenging. Even during worship just now, two names come to my mind. Now, it doesn't mean that these people are people that you wish you never see again for the rest of your life. I don't mean that. It could be someone that you've had dealings with and leave them alone, see what will happen. Hopefully next year they will change. Or someone you will think that, so old already, I say one time, two times, three times, I don't want to say anymore. Okay, somebody in that category, all right? Oops, sorry. Do you love him or her? Are you patient with him? Are you kind to him? This came to mind yesterday. I was telling last night's people, like, you know, sometimes we are so exasperated. I would say, okay, I'll be patient with him. I won't scold him anymore. You know? But when you see them making wrong decisions and going to bang the wall, as we say, let him bang the wall. If he doesn't bang the wall, he will never learn. And then when he bangs the wall and he gets hurt and then he needs help, then he'll come crawling back and say sorry, and then I will tell him, I'll be kind. I won't say I told you so, but actually in my head, I'm saying I told you so. We are patient, we think, but we are not being kind. Same thing, we have only one Holy Spirit, and those were nine aspects of the Holy Spirit. When you read 1 Corinthians 13 and it tells you, love is this, can you say that you are showing love if you want to be kind but not be patient? Or can you say that you are showing love if you are patient but you don't want to be kind? You cannot. You cannot slice it up and divide it into portions because it is one whole thing. So love is everything included. Love is patient and love is kind. If you are patient and not kind, you are not showing God's love. You are still showing your own kind of love. Are you praying with hope for the person? Have you given up? Remember, we said being patient means don't succumb to trials. Don't give in. Don't give up. Are you still praying for him? Are you still praying for him to change? Are you still praying for God to work in his life? Are you still praying that God will bless him? You know what's most difficult? Sometimes we complain to God. We actually don't pray. We come to God and say, you know, God, He is like that, He is like that. You know, I told Him how many times He won't listen. Then I told Him, don't do this, He still did this. I told Him, don't go there, He still go there. I told Him, don't like that, He still like that. You know, we are complaining to God. And then at the end of it, we say, God, please help him lah. But actually, we spend 99% of the prayer complaining. And then at the end, okay, God, please help him. In Jesus' name, amen. That is not praying with hope, okay? That is maybe just letting go your frustrations to God, that's all. But when we pray with hope, what does it mean? God, you know he shouldn't have done that. He's in a bad deal. Can you please send a friend to advise him? Can you please help him get a good lawyer? Can you please give him someone who can give him good advice to tell him how to manage his finances? You know, that's praying, giving him hope, blessing him. God, give him good health. Let him be able to find a job. You know his giftings. You know his weaknesses. You know he cannot manage stress. God, can you please open a door for him? Get him a job that he can do well. Give him a friend who will encourage him. God, he doesn't listen to me anymore. Can you send him a friend who will encourage him? You know, that's praying with hope because you want to see change for that person's sake, not for your own sake. Are you treating him in a way that will lead him to repentance? Like they will tell parents, do you close the door to your children? Do your children know that they can come to you at any point of time in their life? If my daughters were pregnant before they got married, can they come to me and say, Mom, I'm sorry, I got something to tell you? Can they still come to me and tell me that? I have to make sure that my love to my children is unconditional, that they will know that no matter what happens, if they hit rock bottom, no matter how bad the situation, they know that the only people that they can trust and ask for help from is still their parents. No matter how painful, no matter how bad. Do we deal with one another like that? Are we treating each other in that way that allows them to repent, that allows them to make it right? These are things I have thought of before. I've asked God, what kind of love do I show my children? Is it conditional or unconditional? In my mind, I may think I'm showing unconditional love, but by the words that I say, by the way I express myself to them, do my children feel that it is unconditional, or do they feel that it is still conditional? And only this thing, God can change me. How I show my children unconditional love. It's not easy, because we have to do things we do not usually do. We have to say things we do not usually say. Are you giving encouragement to this person? How do we love? And I'm not talking about loving God. I'm talking about loving one another. Let's read James 5, 7 to 10 again. Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Do not grumble against one another, brothers or sisters, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. How many of you are farmers here? I only know two farmers, they are not here. Okay, the rest of y'all, do you plant anything? Yes. I hope you're not like me, okay? I can testify, Phoebe knows, the kind of plants that don't need care and don't die. Okay, I don't have green fingers. But you can go to some of your homes, your flowers are beautiful. I can appreciate good plants. It's just that I'm lousy at them. But what do you do while you are waiting? You sow the seed, and then you just pray it won't die. Cannot. What do you do after you sow the seed? You need to water it. You need to pull out the weeds. Right? You've got to do everything that you possibly can and leave the sun and the rain to God. But anything else, it's not sun and rain, it's your work. Correct? You cannot just sow the seed and let it grow and hope that you have a good crop. It doesn't happen that way. So some people will say that, I will pray for that person and just pray only lah. I'm not saying that God cannot do anything. But I'm saying that as human beings, we have a responsibility to carry. We cannot just say, I pray for the person only and that's all. Because many times God will ask us to show love as how Christ has loved us. Sometimes it takes time, it takes effort for you to call someone, to message someone, to visit someone, to find out how they are doing. Because that is part of the encouragement of showing love, to show them that God still loves them. If you speak to people who were former drug addicts, I can safely say none of them came to the drug rehab center because they just suddenly felt like it one day. Some come to the drug rehab center because they see how broken-hearted their mother became. And because of the love for the mother, they agreed to come to the drug rehab center to try to get things right. Some come to the drug rehab center because someone died. And it suddenly gave them a slap and woke them up. I must try to get my life right. But none of them came because they woke up the next morning and decided it was a good thing to get their life straight. All of us are in a journey. You know, it's just like, this is the picture I had during worship just now. Like, we are all going to go for a run, marathon. 10 kilometers, 5 kilometers, like if you're not a marathon runner. Okay, and then like we are all going to go to the starting line and there's this huge big mass of people, you know, and we're all coming and it's like, I'm coming here and I say, oh, there's Chong Hyang, huh? Oh, there's Phoebe. You know, it's like even though I may not know her personally, I may not speak to her, the fact that we are here at the race, we smile to one another. Why? Because we know to reach here, we must have had exercised a lot, run a lot. We had to make sacrifices. We had to endure pain to come to this starting line to take part in this run together. When you are alone with God, when you are worshiping, it is actually you alone with God. Even in this hall of 300 people, it is actually just you and the Lord when you worship, when you pray. It is not a composite thing. But why do we come to church? Why does the Word of God say not forsaking to come together? Why? To encourage one another. That when you see each other in church, you smile and say, not just to be friendly, but to say that, I'm glad you are in church today. I'm glad you still love the Lord. I'm glad you are setting aside 2 hours of your time on Sunday morning to come and honor God here together. So when you look around and you see, hey, that chair, the uncle that sits in that chair all the time, he's not there today. I wonder where he is. I hope he comes next week. And if he doesn't come for a long time, you can ask Christine, you can ask one of the ushers, hey, you know the uncle that always sits in that chair? If he always sits in that chair, everybody knows who he is. You know? Is the uncle all right? I haven't seen him around for a while. What is that? Showing love. And these are the things that God will bring to your mind for you to show His love to someone else. Love is patient. Love is kind. Some people find it easier to show love to strangers. Because it is out of my, it's not so close. It won't hurt me. You know, if the stranger accepts, fine. The stranger don't accept, never mind. You know, but who hurts me? I've come to the conclusion, only 5 people can hurt me. My husband and my 4 children. Because these are the people who are closest to me. These are the people who know me in and out. They know what my life principles are, what my plans are, how I view things, how I want things done. Everything about me, they know. So because of that, they are the most likely people who can hurt me. Anyone else, even my best friend, will not hurt me so badly that I cannot recover. Because it's just a friend. You know, I will still find a way to forgive her lah, and make excuses for her, and there can still be reconciliation. But the ones who are closest to you, the smallest thing they do, sometimes they didn't backstab you, just answer you back in a certain way. Oh, you feel so hurt. Why? Because they're the closest to you. But in order to love, what do we need to do? We need to not get easily offended. For example, if you come early Sunday morning and I'm having a practice with the worship team, you know, and I'm not wearing my shoes on stage, somebody can get offended. Ayo, this worship leader, come to stage, don't wear shoes on. I mean, somebody can get offended by something like that and feel that, oh yeah, this church like that, this worship leader like that, no decorum at all, doesn't know how to behave herself in church. Then you can get offended. Some of us are easily offended by the smallest things. And as I get older, I remind myself, don't be like some old auntie, you know, hiya, come in, never call me. You know, some, because I have seen some of my relatives, you know, who are upset over the smallest things. Chinese New Year, we pray for months before Chinese New Year, because sometimes people get offended over the slightest things. You know, you offer something, you didn't offer the eldest person first. You offered somebody not so old first. The eldest person also can get offended. We can laugh because it doesn't happen to us, or you can laugh because you know it happened in your family before. But these things do happen. You know, when you talk about offenses, it could be small things, and you think, ayo, why are they so angry with one another? This is such a small thing. You know, there's bigger problems in the world. But when you are the person who is offended, it is a very big thing to you. So I just want to encourage you all, do not be easily offended. Because then it is difficult to show love. It is difficult to receive love also. Shall we read 1 Corinthians 13 again? Before we read that, I just want to remind you of this one important thing. All of you have the power to influence. Whoever you are, wherever you are. You don't have to be older to be influential. You don't have to be more senior to be influential. You don't have to be in a position of leadership or authority or stand here to be influential. But all of you, wherever you are, whoever you are, in whatever relationship you are influential. We are a child. We have a father, we have a mother, we have father-in-law, we have mother-in-law, we have grandmother, we have grandfather, we have aunties, we have uncles, we have nieces, nephews, cousins, neighbors, colleagues, teachers, students. If you were a hermit, you won't be here this morning. In every day of your life, you have the power to influence someone. You have the ability to love like how God loves, to show that to someone. We read, love never fails. Do you believe love never fails? Do you believe that love hopes all things, believe and endures all things? So the first question is back to us. What do we believe? What is our value system? Do you think love is just a small thing? If it was, then how come we are all here today? It's because Christ came for us. It's because Jesus decided that, yes, he was willing to lay down his life for you and I. As much as it was the will of the Father, the will of the Father, He gave the Son the choice. And He chose to lay down His life for you. God the Father didn't threaten Jesus and hold Him by the collar and put Him on the cross. But as much as the Son loved the Father and loved us, He laid down His life for you and I. Is love not powerful? If that love is powerful enough to change your life and my life, is that same love not powerful enough for you to influence someone else with? Can you not be patient with someone? Can you not love someone as Christ has loved you? If you are in a position of authority, like a parent, let me encourage you, don't give up. It's just like if there's an army attacking and we are standing in one line as a barricade. For you to give up means there is a hole in that line. There is a gap in that line. That means you decided, I'm not going to fight. I'm just going to stand back. Then there is a gap in that line. There is a hole in that line. The protection is for your family. The protection for your children. The protection for the students you have. Don't give up. Don't give in. As much as it hurts, as much as you are exasperated, don't give up. Turn to the Lord. Because this is what God showed me. If I ever reach a point and I'm exasperated with my children and say, give up, God, whatever you want to do, do love with them. You know what God told me? If you give up, who's going to fight for them? Who's going to wage spiritual warfare for them? Who's going to intercede for them? Who's going to give them time to grow up? Give them time to respond to God's work in their life? For that sake, I cannot give up. What is the best thing you can do for your loved ones? Love the Lord. Stay close to the Lord. That's the best thing you can give to them. Amen. Let's read 1 Corinthians 13 and let's put it as I and not love. All right? Ready? I am patient. I am kind. I do not envy. Okay, hang on. I see people looking very sheepishly. Okay? Now, God is perfect, right? And when God comes into our life, what does He give us? Perfect love. Right? So what I'm saying is that, let's say if you have a BMW that can go up to 200 kilometers an hour without exploding, but you're only driving at 110 because that's the speed limit in Malaysian highway. I won't ask you how fast you go. Okay? But what does that mean? Just because you're going at 110, does it mean that you are not able to go 200? No, it was made to be able to go 200. So what I'm saying is that you may feel, I don't say this so loudly because I'm not so patient, I'm not so kind, I am envious, so I don't want to read so loudly. No, what I want you to do is that this is what the potential, this is what God's love can be in your life. You may feel that, really, man? Yes, it is true. All right? But it will come to pass more and more every day. All right? So please, read it out loud because you have the perfect love of Christ in your life. Amen? 1 Corinthians 13, let's go. I am patient. I am kind. I do not envy. I do not boast. I am not proud. I do not dishonor others. I am not self-seeking. I am not easily angered. I keep no record of wrongs. I do not delight in evil, but rejoice with the truth. I always protect, always trust, I always hope, always persevere. Amen? Let's rise. Let's pray. Father, we come before you and we just want to be honest with you. Lord, we want to love you with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind and all our strength. Lord, we want to love our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, we want to love one another as you have loved us. Lord, we want to love with your kind of love, not our kind, because your love is perfect. It is your love that softens the heart. It is your love that gives hope. It is your love that gives encouragement. It is your love that gives strength. Father, we just ask for a healing of our scarred hearts, Lord. You know the wounds we have in our heart, the relationships that hurt. Lord, we bring it before you. Lord, we ask for a new heart. A heart that is soft towards you. A heart that will respond the way you respond. God, we are not able to do it ourselves. It is too difficult. It is painful. It's tiring. But Lord, we need your love. Your love that covers a multitude of sins. Your love that will always protect. Your love that will always trust, always hope, always persevere. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.